Welcome to the vodcast for chapter 18, lesson 1. This vodcast is about the sun, earth, and moon system. So tonight, we'll be talking about three big ideas for this unit, or for this lesson, rather. The first is, how does the earth move? And we talked a little bit about this in class, but we're going to just emphasize some points here. The second is, why is the earth warmer at the equator and colder at the poles? And then the last one that we'll discuss is, why do the seasons change as the earth moves around the sun? So those are the three big things that I want you to take away from this lecture that we do. So the first thing, the big idea number one, is basically, how does the earth move around the sun? And you can see the title here says earth moves around the sun in a nearly circular path. So pretty much it's a circle. You can see on this side over here on around July 4th, the earth hits its point where it is farthest away from the sun by 152 million miles. On January 3rd, it's at its closest point. It's 147 million kilometers, but it's 147 million kilometers away. Point is, these are really, really big numbers. We're pretty good distance from the sun, and they're not very different. We're talking about a difference of here of only about 5 million kilometers, which sounds like a lot, but really it's not when you're talking about hundreds of millions of kilometers, 147 million kilometers. It's not that big of a difference. Another interesting thing is, a lot of students think that one of the things that causes the seasons is how far away the Earth is from the sun. But you can see that's really not the case, because here in July, where the Earth is the farthest from the sun, we experience summer in the northern hemisphere. And so we know that the distance from the sun really doesn't have anything to do with, the seasons or temperature or anything like that. Now, luckily here it says the Earth's motion without the gravitational pull would be something like this, and we'd be scurrying off into space. But luckily there is this gravitational pull. There's this inward attraction towards the sun. We talked about this a little bit earlier, or very early in the year, when we talked about the formation of our solar system and the formation of the Earth and the moon. But luckily there is this inward force pulling us in. We call that force gravity. It's just the attraction between the sun and the Earth. Now, we talked in class about this. We watched a short video talking about that the Earth orbits the sun, like we said just a second ago, because the gravity pulls it in. The path that the Earth follows, we call that Earth's orbit. Now, the motion of one object around another is called the revolution. So if we have the sun here in the middle, the Earth out here, and it's going around the sun, okay, this is its orbit. This path that it follows is called its orbit. And as it moves around, we call that a revolution. One revolution is when the Earth makes one trip all the way around the sun. That's called a revolution. And we complete a revolution about every 365 days, or we say 365 and a quarter. Now, some people have pointed out in class as we're working this out that this actually, over a period of a couple years, if you were to add 365 up four times, or if we were to multiply that by four, you end up with this equaling almost an entire day, right? This is almost like 0.25, which would be a quarter, okay? Multiply that by four, you get a whole extra day. So every fourth year, we have what's called a leap year, where instead of 365 days, we have 366. And the reason we do that is because otherwise we'd be celebrating, New Year's a day off, okay, every 4 years. And so, we'd be celebrating New Year's in July after a couple of, numerous years down the road. So that's what leap year is all about. This year happens to be a leap year, and we talked a little bit about that when we were going through our leap day. Now, there's revolution, which is us moving around the sun, and then there's this spinning motion, which we call rotation, okay? And that's just the Earth rotating on its axis, and we call that its rotational axis, appropriately enough. And the tilt of the Earth's rotation axis is always the same direction by the same amount. And what that means is, again, sun here in the middle, we've talked about this in detail, tilt of the Earth is in this direction, here, 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 no matter where it is, the tilt of the axis, or the rotational axis, is always the same no matter where you are in the revolution of the Earth around the sun. Now, the second big idea we're going to talk about is the idea of why is it that it's much warmer at the equator compared to being much colder at the poles. And this is a kind of a good example here. They show there's a little flashlight, and it's just pointed at a piece of paper. And you can see when it's vertical, when it's pointed straight at it, you can see there's a pretty small area that all that energy is concentrated into. Okay, and this kind of represents what happens at the equator, where you get all of that concentrated sunlight at one location. Now, up at the top, so we're thinking about the equator being here, but then, of course, the surface of the Earth is curved. Up towards the poles here, there's a much more curved surface, so it's much more like hitting this tilted piece of paper. And instead of having that small area where that energy is concentrated, you can see now we've got this large area, okay, where it's spread out. Now, it's still the same amount of energy, same flashlight, okay? So it's the same amount of energy. It's just spread out over a much greater area. And so if you take the same amount of energy and spread it out over a greater area, then it appears less, or it feels like less. And so this is more like what we have at the poles. And this is why we have lower temperatures at the poles. And there's an example or a real picture here that shows, again, in the middle here near the equator, you've got that small circle. You've got that small area where all the sun's energy is concentrated. But up here, you can see because of the tilt of the Earth, we have a much more exaggerated circle. And that energy gets spread out and diffused, and it's not as powerful up there, which means that the poles are always going to be a bit colder, or a bit cooler at least, than the equator. And that's why the equator kind of maintains that semi-constant, warm temperature. Now, the last thing we're going to talk about, and probably the most confused when we study this topic, is the idea, big idea number three, and that's what causes the seasons. Now, we've already spent some time in class on this, but I just want to make sure we reiterate these points so that you understand them. Now, the picture that's shown here, this would be a solstice. In fact, this would be what we call northern hemisphere summer solstice, okay? Because you can see the northern hemisphere, the sun's out here. We know that because this big yellow block here represents the sun coming from this direction, okay? So the northern hemisphere is pointed towards the sun. Now, the reason that this is summer for northern hemisphere when it's pointed at the sun is because this light, or the light from the sun, it's going to receive more direct radiation. And we talked about this when we had our equinox just last month. So all the rays that are coming in this direction are pretty much hitting the surface of the sun, or the surface of the Earth, pretty much dead on, especially in these lower latitudes. Now, as we get a little higher up, it's not going to be as direct, but it's still a pretty direct amount of radiation. Now, if we look down here in the southern hemisphere, though, this energy that comes in, it kind of bounces off. It's not as direct. And so these are the words I want you to be using here, is direct versus indirect. Okay? And that's because you can see it hits the Earth at a greater angle, and some of this radiation just kind of bounces off. It's not absorbed as much. And so the northern hemisphere is going to receive so much more direct radiation that that's going to cause northern hemisphere summer. Now, the opposite is true when the southern hemisphere is pointed towards the sun. Okay, now the southern hemisphere is going to receive all of this direct radiation. You can see it's basically exactly the opposite of what we had and the last slide. Okay, so here this radiation is going to be coming off at more of an angle, and it's going to bounce off. So that now the northern hemisphere is getting that indirect sunlight, and the southern hemisphere in this case is getting direct sunlight. Okay, and that's because the southern hemisphere is pointed, or the southern axis, I should say, is pointed towards the sun. And then the last example, not a solstice, would be of an equinox. And this is when neither axis is pointed towards the sun. So this happens twice a year also. And you can see the axis here is along the path of the orbit, or excuse me, yeah, I could say orbit or revolution around the sun. And so this axis, sun's over here, axis is at a 90-degree angle to that. Neither axis is pointed towards or away from the sun. And so both hemispheres, the northern and the southern, receive the same amount of sunlight. Okay, and that's why we call it equal, right? Equinox means equal night, which just means we're getting the same amount of sunlight, same amount of nighttime on the northern and southern hemisphere, and that happens twice a year. So my question to you for this evening, for your bell work, is going to be this. Now, before I give you your homework, please make sure you pay attention here, that you email the address that's shown above. Please do not email my school board address. Okay, I won't be checking there for my emails on homework. I'll only be checking this email. Also, very important, make sure you email it with the subject season. I'm gonna go through my inbox. I'm gonna filter these out by only emails that have the subject line season. So if you don't put season as a subject line, you do not get credit for this vodcast. So subject is season, and email that to lynchhw@gmail.com. Okay. So here is my question. Very simple. Okay. At this location, right here, okay, right here, this location of the earth, what season is the northern hemisphere currently in? Okay. Also, what season is the southern hemisphere currently in this location? Okay, sun's here, earth is here, you can see the axis is shown for you. What season is the northern hemisphere in? What season is the southern hemisphere in? Okay, that's your homework. You will get 100 points if you email it to the correct location with the correct subject and the correct season for the north and southern hemisphere. If you don't know it, go back, watch. I just explained it. Have a great night.